Hello, Zero K fans, and welcome to Nanolathe the Dawn. I'm your host, ShadowFury333, with another match between Juletz and Sisseroth. This was actually a request from Juletz after the last match I casted, because apparently this one went better. And I am curious to see how that goes, so let's see how that goes. Also, as I mentioned before, I do oblige requests, generally speaking. So I'm very glad to have this. Anyway, Juletz going for Light Vehicle Factory, early Dark coming out, while Sisseroth going for the Jump Pod Factory. And last time, this was roughly... No, it was, last time was a Clokey in Jump Pod, wasn't it? Anyway, the... No, Jump Pod versus Light Vehicle. Yeah, the same. This is the same matchup as last time. The difference being that Sisseroth was in the Southwest last time. That's right. That's... No, that's wrong. This is, as far as I can tell, the same matchup as last time. Now, last time, we saw... No, I was right the first time. Because Juletz had the Northeast. They were trying to take the center, and they went from there to taking... Or they need to get... They went from there to taking the center kind of convincingly, and then the sumo came in later on from Sisseroth and basically broke things. Like, we really got to see how powerful the sumo can be when it's able to gravity gun enemies into moderators. This time, on the other hand, right off the bat, we are seeing the dart actually managing to get in. It needs to get some wind generators. That's the first order of business. Get wind generators, get rid of the power infrastructure, and it's not quite doing so. It needs to... There we go. There's the position it needs. There's it dying because wind generators do have an explosion radius. Always remember, every single unit has an explosion radius. In this case, wind generators are actually fairly big. Oops. Like... How, you click on something and then hold space X to get the explosion radius, and the number there is the amount of damage it'll deal when it explodes. Yeah, wind generators are dangerous things. That's a big reason why you don't want to build wind generators right next to other wind generators. Like, having it separated like this is the matter of course, because otherwise they'll end up chain reacting, and then you lose your entire wind farm. Which is very embarrassing, and of course, rather detrimental to the general goal of trying to win the game by using money to pay for units in order to have them destroy your opponent's infrastructure. Since you don't have any money. Anyway, Juletz getting a bit of a counterattack here as the pyro coming in from Sisseroth not able to actually do as much damage. So neither player able to put in much effective harassment, but they are able to get information. At this point, Juletz actually does know that Sisseroth doesn't have much outside of their base, and Sisseroth knows that Juletz is expanding rapidly. That being said, their economies are about the same at the moment, but that's primarily because Sisseroth is relying a lot on overdrive. Juletz, on the other hand, actually is short on energy, so not only are they not relying on overdrive, they don't have enough power to even support what they have so far. Thankfully for them, they're nowhere near excessing, so it'll be fine. They just need to continue to build power structures as they are right now. Or at least were, that still need more, but that should be built up in time. Sisseroth, on the other hand, getting standard expansions around their base, and that should work beautifully. So both players are expanding at roughly the same rate. They have economies that are more or less on par, with the exception of differences in overdrive and reclaim. At this point, though, looks like Juletz going for... Well, the early leveler, which is an interesting choice that I don't really agree with. I mean, we're coming into moderators, and I mentioned before... No, the last thing I was talking about with moderators was an argument that you'd want to use a bunch of cheap, fast units and then tank through the shots, and then come in later on with something like a Ravager if you need to clear everything else up. But basically, come in with a bunch of Scorchers, and then the Scorchers that get through will kill the moderators. That being said, Juletz wouldn't succeed with that. Sisseroth has already thought of this, does have a star to stop. This would completely stop any Scorchers coming in, so there you go. Sisseroth already has in mind what they need to do to counter the thing that would likely counter their current composition. Good job there. This point... It's looking pretty bad overall. It's kind of iffy for Sisseroth. I mean, they're not expanding as quickly. Both players going for the geothermal plant, which I'm actually kind of surprised by. At this stage in the game, going for the geoplant is really risky. Now, Sisseroth actually makes a lot of sense, because they are going for overdrive as a major economic force. If they set that up and then get a bunch of wind gens, or even just a pylon or two, between there and the top wind gens, they'll probably end up getting about, let's see, 35 energy on top of the... They'll probably end up getting an additional 10 metal per second between this entire chain. And that's exactly what they're doing. Going through all the overdrive just to get the overdrive set up. With Juletz, on the other hand, they're obviously being more forward. They're taking more territory, and that's difficult to hold. Like, that is a risky move. It's not a move that you often question because, of course, the game is built around making territory grabs, and that's the entire point of the game, is you claim territory in order to get the money, in order to get more units, in order to claim more territory, in order to win. But, well, in order to get more units, in order to kill your opponent. But the point is, Juletz is building up where Sisseroth is being very defensive. And the thing is, Juletz, if they were to go for a gunship switch or an airplane switch, this would be thoroughly irresponsible. Like, what Sisseroth is doing right here is just going to get them completely wrecked. However, with the heavy tank switch, it's possible that we'll be broken through, but at this point, Sisseroth is in a great position to just build up defenses. They have a strong economic basis in their main base. So, basically, with about a quarter of the map, they're going to be able to hold what Juletz has taken with about a third of the map, if not more. Now, Juletz is also going for the Geoplanet, but has not, as far as I can tell, set up much of an infrastructure for Overdrive. They do have a pylon setting up, so they do have that to connect things, but they don't have anywhere near as much energy. Like, their actual power infrastructure, and there it is, the Overdrive plus 6.7, not as much as I expected, actually. But still good. But yeah, and also having a much safer power infrastructure overall. So Sisseroth right now, they have a great power infrastructure. They actually have decent amount of production. Getting another caretaker is exactly what they need to do. Juletz, on the other hand, is accessing. They are, however, kind of making up for this through the attack over in the eastern side of the map. So this is a bit of a blow, a bit of a, actually, testament to what Sisseroth is doing and why it's not a bad idea. Because Sisseroth right now is not defending much well. They do have the Sumo and they do have the Moderators, so that is going to be the same setup as last time. However, they only have 6 Moderators. Last time they had 9, and they do have more Stardusts, which is the difference. That Sumo is probably going to be pulling units in into the Stardust range as well as the Moderator range, and that will naturally be fatal. However, Juletz finally has the Tank Factory up and getting the Caretakers on top of that, so they should stop accessing pretty soon, especially with the Reaper coming. They need that. Like, they need to avoid accessing, because, boy, Reapers are expensive. But if they get that set up, that should deal with the Stardust no problem. The Moderators will be a bit of a pain, but the Reaper will be able to tank them to some extent. I mean, they deal 500 damage each. So they will take about 14 shots, actually, to deal with the Reaper. The amount of Moderators is not high enough for that, so this Reaper will be useful. It should tank things well enough. I mean, if it takes all the hits, then the Ravagers get in and just wreck face. And if it doesn't tank all the hits, then it doesn't get damaged and it can wreck up all the defenses and there's no problem there. But it looks like Juletz is trying to bring this down to one big smash. One major attack that just steamrolls over Sisseroth's forces. Sisseroth, on the other hand, they're defending. They're setting up very slowly, crawling across the map, setting up what they can. They have their economy building up over the northwest. They have some more metal extractors being claimed, and overall, their economy is very overdrive-based, but yeah, so is Juletz, actually. At this point, Juletz does have their pylon set up. They do have the geoplant connecting to everything in their main base. So both players are going for the more overdrive-focused strategy, which is a little unusual. Understandable, but a little unusual. But now we're finally getting a bit more raiding coming in. And like I said, this is kind of why you see this, though the Moderators are protecting it. Sisseroth has not rebuilt this yet. These Eastern Metal Extractors have not been built up again. So Juletz is still at an economic advantage. They do have more territory, which of course does mean that they can be more easily raided, but they have defenses around those as well. And honestly, it doesn't look like Sisseroth is planning to raid. It looks like Sisseroth is just planning to smash through Juletz's main base and be done with it. So, given that, I can see why Juletz is just building up as they are. There's no real fear. At this point, though, it looks like Sisseroth is the one that's going to be engaging. Juletz is aware of this. They have full knowledge of what Sisseroth is setting up for. They just aren't engaging until Sisseroth gets close. And there it is, the Reaper's coming in. And first Ravager getting torn to pieces, but I'm not sure how much this matters. The Reapers are very difficult to move. They're way heavier than anything else, so getting rid of them is going to be a challenge. And not only that, the sheer amount of units. I mean, the Sumo is taking all the attention here. The Moderators, out of ammo. They're trying desperately to reload, but they don't have enough time to do so before getting completely wrecked. This is away from the Stardust that I'm guessing Sisseroth wanted to engage in. Sisseroth probably wanted to engage by the Stardust. like pull units in and all that stuff, as I mentioned. And now they're not really able to do so, having lost almost everything. And just about everything, losing their commander as well. There goes their storage and a lot of their economy. Far more than their economy than I expected to lose, actually. And with that, the Sumo going down on top of that means two Reapers and a Banisher. Having to deal with the Firewalker, sure, but still, two Reapers and a Banisher basically can just go back, get repaired, or at least the Reaper can. The Banisher's possibly dead, but the Reaper can definitely go back, get repaired, and then start breaking through. Juliet's still has the economic advantage. Juliet's massively massively reduced Sithroth's army. There's not much left. I mean, as soon as the Reaper and Banisher are repaired, then Juliet's can move out and just steamroll everything. There's not much left to defend. There's the Firewalker. And that's about it. And it looks like, other than that, Sithroth is just building workers. I'm not sure if they're planning to go to a factory switch or what they have in mind. Juliet's, on the other hand, going for Leveler, Ravager, Banisher, Reaper. Just going for basically the same strategy with two different factories. And that is going to work out quite well given the compositions they're fighting right now. So I'm not really sure what motivated these two players to go for a very overdrive-oriented strategy. I mean, I mentioned before, it is easier to defend, but it's very atypical. Most players, I mean, the meta of 0K in general is that you want to take the territory because you do get metal faster. Like, it's easier to get metal by setting up a bunch of metal extractors. The amount of metal you get through overdrive, it scales with the number of metal extractors far better than it scales with the amount of energy you have. But yet, both of these players have gone for a very overdrive-oriented strategy. Juliet's less so, and as we can see, Juliet's is benefiting a great deal from that. Sithroth, they're... Oh, that's why. I didn't even notice. Yeah, the geothermal generator is being upgraded, which is why it's having a hard time with the energy production. But on the other hand, Juliet's just has all this territory that Sithroth isn't even going for. Like, we haven't seen any raiding. Sithroth's entire strategy has involved a mainline massive assault attack onto Juliet's main base, which... If it weren't for the fact that Juliet's was prepared for that, it would have worked fairly well. But Juliet's had heavy enough units that it wasn't going to be a problem. However, against most other players, there wouldn't be the Sumos. They'd probably, for a jump bot factory, there would be... Moderators would happen, but a lot of Pyros would happen. And possibly Puppies as well, especially if you're dealing with, like, all these Reapers. You'd probably see... I mean, you would see Moderators. You'd probably see a lot of Pyros as well. And... It just seems weird that Sithroth has not gone for that at all. They are going for a Strider Hub, probably going to get a Dante. Although, I'm not sure if I can call this, because these players are not doing the more typical strategies that I see in a 1v1. So I honestly have no idea. And Jax, of course. Thank you, Orphelius. Why did I forget Jax? I always forget Jax. Jax are the best. Jax would be the option to go for, actually, more than anything. Or Scuttles, pointing out as well. Yeah, okay, there's... Jumpbot has options is the point. The Jumpbot factory does have a lot of options to deal with heavy units that don't involve Firewalker Moderator. And Firewalker Moderator is not bad for that, but it's like, still, there's a lot of options to deal with this stuff. And the options gone for are not the typical ones. My point. At any rate, Sithroth is losing the one expansion they did manage to take, and Juliet's way ahead in economy. I mean, there was a bit of equalizing when Sithroth got that geothermal, the advanced geothermal generator. But even then, their overdrive is the only thing keeping them competitive right now. Given that they have way less territory. They have maybe a third of the map, and Juliet's has a solid half. Juliet's is only barely ahead, and actually slightly behind right now, thanks to the overdrive. So I can see the rationale there. But that being said, Juliet's is still having an easier time setting this up, just because, well, I mean, they have their overdrive. It's far more valuable for way less energy. Like, consider, they're getting +8 on overdrive for 23 energy, as opposed to Sithroth's spending... over 100 energy, often has 80, 90 energy, to get an extra 12 metal, just because it's only an overdrive on 4 plus 2 metal extractors. Actually, Sithroth would benefit a great deal from putting in a few pylons just across here, like one pylon right about here, and another pylon here, just to get these two metal extractors in. I mean, with the amount of energy they have, there's more than enough to easily bump them up to like plus 15, plus 16, possibly even, probably not plus 20, but definitely like plus 16, 17, with the amount of energy they have. And switching over. Wow, hard switch to Shieldbot. Not even keeping the jump bot. Using the jump bot instead as a reclaim food to get the Shieldbot factory more easily. Get the storage up for it. That I don't ever see. Seriously, I've never seen a player. I can't remember the last time a player, if ever, has done that. Has actually reclaimed a factory in order to build a new one. That is new to me. That is really weird, but that is new. So that's a thing that happened. And Juliet's reading an air switch, which is not happening. In fact, no one's gone for air at all this game. It's 15 minutes into the game and no air units have been built. I honestly am not surprised. I mean, Juliet's is surprised. They are making a hard read on air switch, which is not at all what's happening. We're getting a Dante instead, but Juliet's is prepped for that. That won't be a problem. But yeah, had Sisseroth gone for air, it would have been an issue. But Sisseroth, I guess they realized that would have been a possibility and are instead going for Racketeers. Getting the anti-heavy units, getting, well, the EMP to get rid of the Reapers. It's a good choice. I mean, Sisseroth is making a very proper tactical decision in this situation. It's a bit of a read. They might not know that Juliet's is going hard for anti-air, but they do have no air, and they aren't planning to get air. And that's pretty much exactly right in this situation. And Juliet's isn't getting air either. At any rate, the Dante being forced back a little bit, and it is going to be an issue. It looks like Juliet's should be able to deal with this, no problem. Sisseroth pulling everything back into the range of the Stardust, and while there are some problems being caused by... Oh! There's the Scuttle! That's what they needed. There we go! Sithroth cracking open Juliet's army with that one Scuttle. I mean, it looked like, oh, it's going to be all right, but now, no. There's not much hope here. These Reapers unable to do any meaningful damage, getting stunned out or disarmed out before they're able to do enough to get rid of the Dante. And pulling into the Stardust was also a clever move. So right now, Juliet's is in a position where it's going to be difficult for them to attack directly. This is the benefit of an overdrive-based strategy, is that you can concentrate your defenses on your main base, especially in a map like this with the ramps. That makes for more natural choke points. So the way that Sisseroth is set up right now, Juliet's options are going to have to be a little bit less Brute Force. I mean, Brute Force is going to be countered pretty directly by Racketeers. And while there's no anti-air, Juliet's hasn't gone for air. Juliet's could theoretically go for Infernos and then break up the overdrive chain. If the overdrive chain was broken, Sisseroth would have no money whatsoever. Like, Sisseroth is only economically competitive because these wind generators are here. An Inferno or even Phoenix, whatever, coming in here, that would wreck everything. Although the nice thing about Inferno is that it's difficult to counter that because it's a missile silo. Like, it just flies in and explodes and burns stuff up. Or, of course, the other option is the Eoses. But, you know, Inferno's here, and Eoses to get rid of the Dante and possibly get rid of the advanced geoplant. That would completely wreck Sisseroth. Actually, getting rid of the advanced geoplant would break open this entire area because it would kill the geoplant, and the explosion would probably kill... See, the explosion... Yeah, oh, yeah, wow, 9,500. Yes, that would kill everything here. Nothing would survive that. The Dante wouldn't survive that right now. However, that would require a couple Eoses to get rid of that. But yeah, if the geoplant went down, that is a nuke, basically. That, as far as I'm aware, is about the same amount of power as a strategic nuke, like a silencer nuke. So I'm not sure why that wasn't the target during the initial attack. I mean, I kind of know why. Obviously, the Dante is a very clear target. But I would suggest, I would personally go for a missile silo. It's a bit of a personal thing. A lot of other players would either go for Wyverns or would go for... at this point, Black Dawns, probably. They're going to go for gunships. But no, it looks like Juliet's is going in with the same force as last time, and once again, we see the Racketeers not really giving any quarter here. I mean, the Reapers are able to compete toe-to-toe with the Dante. There's quite a few of them, actually. How many are there? Okay, there's five Reapers. That is the cost of a Strive right there. So it's going to be a fairly easy thing to set up. I mean, right now, it is rather difficult for Sisseroth and Juliet's to be fighting in a way that neither of them is going to be able to get out. Like, Juliet's is in a position where they're losing a lot of units as they're moving in. If they don't win this, Sisseroth is going to be able to reclaim their way back into the game. If they win this, that should be game. If they manage to get rid of the Dante, then there's not much stopping anything else. Most of the Racketeers are gone, or yeah, pretty much out of commission. The Dante is still around, though. It's almost there, it goes. Dante's down, And with that, there's not a whole lot of opposition. Juliet's pretty much won this. Scythroth still providing quite a bit of resistance, though, thanks to these two racketeers. They are not helping at all. But yeah, at this point, the one thing that needs to happen yet is getting rid of the power infrastructure. Like, getting rid of Scythroth's economy. Because that is primarily where it comes in from. I mean, Juliet's right now, it's almost impossible for Scythroth to break back through this. Like, given what Juliet's has, Scythroth getting forced back by all those Reapers was a massive blow. Now, that being said, they are going for quite a few thugs, about 10 thugs coming in here, which would be able to deal with most of the peripheral stuff. They went around here, got rid of the defenders, maybe went around the back. Going through the northwest would be unwise. It's way too defended. But any other part of the map should be fine. The only thing is, Scythroth doing that would leave them wide open. And I don't think they want to do that. That being said, they don't have to. I mean, they have the Dante, the reclaim for the Dante. They have the reclaim for all this stuff here. How much metal is here? Yeah, 3,000 metal. So no problems there whatsoever. But on the other hand, Juliet's has two Goliaths and four Reapers and a couple Banishers too, why not? But yeah, there's a lot of things here. There's a lot, and it's not gonna be easy to deal with, if possible at all. Scythroth's one advantage here is the Reclaim is giving them a slight economic advantage, but they're still going pure shield bot with Dante. I mean, the Goliath has quite the splash damage on them, so the thugs basically have no chance. There is not much else I could see being done here other than, honestly, just changing strategy entirely. Like, changing, adding another factory, maybe going for air. I mean, the thing is, there isn't a lot of air defense. There's the defenders around the map, but there's only the Cobra and the Razor. I mean, Juliet seems to have realized no air is likely coming. Or, I mean, the Racketeers made sense. They did stun stuff out that was keeping Scythroth around. And at this point, Scythroth is building their army way faster. I almost wonder if a Scorpion would be the job. I mean, a Scorpion would stun things out. Its D-Gun does, it does have the Stunning Tail D-Gun, so it would be able to stun out the entire army. And that would open things up for Scythroth's army to come in and deal with the rest of it. It's a long shot, but at this point, Scythroth has long shots and not much else. Actually, I guess the other option, given the fact that there's a lot of heavy units, is to just build, like, 24 bandits and start running around the map and tearing apart everything they can. I mean, there's defenses, yes, but just enough numbers. You kind of rush in and deal with most of the defenses, get rid of a bunch of metal extractors, you know, force Juliet's to go around the map, because at this point with Scythroth's reclaim, 24 bandits, that they can hold, they can have that running around the map while still holding the line if Juliet's goes for a counterattack. Or at least no worse than they can right now. Oh, Orphelia's pointing out that Scorpion's useless against Reapers. Well, fair enough. I never see Scorpions anyway, so I'm not super familiar. I never use them either. They're not really that popular for reasons to do with power. They aren't really that strong. But yeah, I don't see Scythroth going for a side raid while trying to set this up. I think if they did, it would make Juliet's panic and counterattack, and then Scythroth, if they position themselves properly, then they'll be able to set that up into a stronger position, at the same time breaking the parts of Juliet's base that aren't really well defended, and having an army in a position that could allow them to basically wreck up what Juliet's has and get back here. So Goliath's coming in and kind of proving their assault here. Not as much splash damage as I expected. Never mind. Still, the slow beam does help a lot though, because the slow beam deals loads of extra damage to shields, which opens up the shields. But yeah, they kind of need the pillager. The pillager would be kind of nice, but they kind of need the banisher around there to provide extra splash damage. And that doesn't seem to be happening. What does seem to be happening is, this is too loud for me. What does seem to be happening is that the banisher coming along the front here to help deal with, again, the Dante, which is once again very much out of position, not getting repaired and dying as a result. So another Dante going down. Scythroth pretty much out of reclaim as well, and this should be it. Juliet's pushing in with a couple Goliaths, four Reapers, a couple Banishers, actually three Goliaths now, with a fourth on the way, but three right here. And it's actually, they're having a hard time thanks to all those Racketeers shooting down, but Once they get through there, if they get rid of the Stardust, it's pretty much over. Yeah, this is over. They're going to go for the Geoplanet, and after that, Sisseroth's entire economy is going to collapse. The only reason Sisseroth has been this close economically has been this Geoplanet. And now that it's gone nuclear, there, which is actually really bizarre, come to think of it, there's not much else to say for it, and Sisseroth throws in the towel. So that was a bit drawn out. I mean, Juliet's pretty much had the game for the majority of the game. Like, right about here, when that first fight went heavily in Juliet's favor with the sumo. I mean, after that point, it was tough because Sisseroth had defended themselves well, but really, there wasn't a whole lot Sisseroth was expanding to, and while they were trying to break out of their base, it became harder and harder every time until finally, well, we saw what happened. They died. Also, Juliet's energy economy got pretty stagnant after a while. Not terribly surprising, but yeah, that's interesting, the difference between them. I mean, really, like I said, Sisseroth was getting back in, keeping relatively on par thanks to their massive energy income. And oh yeah, metal use was almost entirely identical. Unit value was different because Juliet's kept their army alive after the first engagement, and we see that the unit value grows and shrinks at about the same rate. Like, the difference between in unit value between Juliet and Sisseroth stays about the same. Like, there's a bit here where Juliet's lost more than Sisseroth. That was the first big battle over to the north where the Racketeers first came in and really wrecked Juliet's army. But then Sisseroth losing a bunch of stuff and another attack there. And then, of course, the last attack that ended the game. But, yeah, that was, they were really close together. It was really that one change in advantage because of the sumo fight at the beginning that Sisseroth never managed to make up for. And I think if Sisseroth had expanded more with what they had on top of the attack they made and all that, they would have actually been able to get an economic advantage, like a true metal use advantage and unit value advantage. They would have not been stuck in this stagnation where they were basically growing as quickly as Juliet's, but they'd already had a major disadvantage from the beginning. Oh yeah, and the excess graph, not much, actually. Juliet's accessed about 800. Sisseroth accessed about 1,200, 1,300, roughly. Which isn't terrible. It looks like most of it for Sisseroth came up after their commander died. Juliet's just didn't have the production for a little while. And then got the production, and then stopped accessing. See, I was accessing in big chunks, but overall the players weren't accessing for any extended period of time. Which is good to see. Anyway, that was that, and the next match is going to be really long. It's going to be Lamedeus versus Deinfreund. So, get whatever you need. Tea, popcorn, whatever. It's going to be long. Just be ready for that. That'll be up in a couple minutes, so stay tuned.